Maybe if we think about two questions that hopefully at the end of this you might be able to answer a little bit better than you can now, and two questions that I think are probably always on our mind. One is, how do I get senior leaders to appreciate what we can do in learning and development, and maybe to appreciate what we can do with learning technology? So how do I get them to see that my job has a purpose and a real function? And number two, how do I get people to do the training? Okay, so there's two things, and those two things go hand in hand to delivering impact, and you'll see how they come together as we go through. I think the first thing I would say, large percentages of us want to see this difference happen. Towards Maturity do their annual benchmark survey. 84% of people say they want to use e-learning for compliance training. They want to see a change in people's behavior in the area of compliance. 89% say they want to improve customer satisfaction through the use of learning technology. But the bad news is, only 22% report a positive change in staff behavior. So we've got a big chasm there that we've got to ask ourselves. We all want it, but only 22% are saying that they're getting it. And so I think that's the question that should be on our minds. How do we close that gap? How do we increase the number, this 22%? And there are companies who are achieving these things. And they're doing a couple of things really well. And I want to share some of those things with you today. The first thing I want to ask you is, what does impact mean for you? So for some companies, it's going to be improved quality, service quality, possibly. Or productivity. Maybe we want to get our product out the doors faster, or our sales force up to speed more quickly. Maybe it's compliance, but not in the typical tick box. It's in the, actually, I want to see a difference in behavior. I want to see a more compliant or competent behavior out of this. So I would challenge you, every company has, and every learning project has, an impact goal. And before you start any of those projects, be thinking about what that is. Two factors that I think come together, and this is borne out in Towards Maturity benchmark results. This is borne out in results from our clients and awards that we've won over the years. Two factors that come together, and this is going to be what we're going to talk about today: alignment and adoption. And I'll define those as we go through, and I'll give you some tips to how you can improve those two things. But those two things come together to create impact. We've written an article that's in the Inside Learning Technologies June issue, which is a summary of this subject. So if you missed some of the key points, you can go back and read the article as well. And we also have copies of that over on the Acteon stand. But these things really come from years of working with clients like these on e-learning projects, some big strategic projects, some individual, you know, one company data protection course. How does it work? How do we really create impact in those things? We've had some success in awards, and again, those two things, alignment and adoption, have come together to be a key part of the formula in proving results when you go for awards. So if you're thinking about that, it's coming into awards season now, e-learning awards, national training awards, things you might want to do, be thinking about alignment and adoption as two factors that might influence that. Okay. Now, why is alignment important? Why is adoption important? Well, let's talk about what happens when those two aren't working together, okay? First of all, we all want to be up in this area, the high impact business outcomes. We want the service quality. We want the improved customer service. We want compliance. We want all those things that are available for us up there. They're the promise of e-learning. They're the promise of learning and development. We can do this for the business. Okay? But too often, we have a lot of people using training materials that are out there. Let's use the example of there's a lot of Microsoft Word and Excel training available, and people can book themselves onto it and do it till the cows come home. So high adoption, a lot of people doing things, but maybe it's not aligned with what the business really needs. So you're in danger of being in the all force, no vector quadrant. You're doing a lot, But when it comes time to demonstrate to the senior leadership how are you really taking the business forward, you might be a bit lacking. You've got a lot of bums on seats, but not a lot to demonstrate in taking the business forward, perhaps. Now, the other one is what we call the weak T quadrant. I'm on the right track, but not enough people know about it, and not enough people have actually done the training to really make a measurable difference in the business. So can you see how these two things really go hand in hand? I've got to engage my learners. I've got to get them to do the training, but I also have to get them to, I have to design training that really makes a difference to the organization. So that's where I want these two working together to get me into the high impact quadrant. Okay, so what is alignment? What is alignment? Well, it's thinking about one of those goals and maybe several of them, but then aligning the training that you're creating against that goal and working back from that. So at the start of every project, asking the project a series of questions. What are we trying to do with this learning intervention? Where are we actually trying to take the business? And you're designing your learning with that in mind. So we'll come to some questions that we can ask. But we like to think about it in these terms. We start with a business need at that far end. That business need is tied with a business outcome. Okay, so here's our need. Here's the difference that we want to make down here at this end. What happens in the middle is up to you. How can I define the knowledge or skill gap that we can close in order to get that business outcome? What is the actual communication or learning intervention that we're going to put in to make that difference? And then it goes through my company and its culture and its structure and all the things, all the messy bits that the e-learning or learning technology goes into. Those are the things you have to think about. Hopefully, out the other side comes some behavior change, which then leads to some business outcome. So keeping those things in mind, how aligned is my intervention in making that whole process happen? Let's talk about a particular case study. HC1 is a care organization. They were founded back in 2011 out of the ashes of the Southern Cross network of care homes. So if you remember that, it was a very tense time, a lot of unknown futures for the residents and also the employees of those care homes. And HC1 was formed to take about half of those homes and to start a new business, but had a lot of baggage, a lot of training issues to overcome at that point. So they started with about 230 homes and 10,000 residents, 15,000 colleagues. They decided to put learning at the heart of the change program. So they used learning and development, number one, to get staff compliant, but also to change behavior. And so they were focused on one key thing all the way throughout the business. Their impact was kindness. They wanted to increase kind care throughout the organization. They wanted to be known as the kindest care organization in the UK. And so everything was aligned with that. When a course was created, when infection control was created, how does this make us kinder? How is this helping us deliver kind care? So those sorts of questions were asked at every stage of the project. And it permeates through everything about this project. So the program itself was called Touch. So it's about personal interaction. It's about enabling and improving that personal interaction. And they set out to move from a culture of training for compliance to training for quality and kindness. So everything that they did was focused on that kind, not ticking boxes, but actually changing behavior. So when you're doing that, you then have to think, okay, every piece of learning that I'm doing, everything that I'm doing is aiming at making that impact, and you're challenging your learning interventions as you go. So some questions for you to ask at the start of your projects. First thing I'd say is, what does your organization really care about? Where is it trying to go? What is it trying to be? Okay? See if you can answer that question. Put it at the top of the list. Even if you're just doing a subject that you think has no relation to what your business is really about, just start here. Just start here. What's the business care about? What are we trying to achieve? This is a key one. What metrics, what KPIs, what measurements, if we get this right, where should we see a change, up or down on measure? See, work really hard to see if you can answer that question. Where should we see a measurement change based on our on this course? Put that at the top of your list. And how does this project, the project you're working on, the learning intervention you're working on, how does this help us get there? How do I, in learning and development, help in the bigger picture? Okay? Some really good questions to ask at the start of every project to make sure you've got your alignment right. You know, this pays dividends after the project is finished. Pays dividends all the way through as you design. But when the project is finished and you're actually seeing the results, you're able to say, yes, we influenced that. We helped with that. And it goes into your award submission. It goes into the employee newsletter that goes around and says, learning and development helped to do this. Your involvement in that e-learning project helped to do this, and you're sharing that more broadly through the organization. So keep those interventions aimed at the impact that you've chosen. Choose an impact and then make sure you're aligned on it. Okay, what is adoption then? Sometimes we call it engagement. So towards maturity, we use the word engagement. We tend to use adoption, and other people use different things. We use adoption because staff engagement is a bigger thing than engagement with learning technology. So to try not to confuse those two things, we use the word adoption. This is the uptake and the use of learning technology. So some people might say it's just getting people to do the training. And that would be right. It's getting people to do the training that you've created and that is out there. Someone else might say, well, we've put this Yammer site together and we really want people to use it. So it might be getting people to use the tools that you've put in place. Someone else might say, and this would be true as well, it's seeing learning technology as an enabler. We've created a learning organization and people see that we're the go-to people for delivering benefits to the business and we can use learning technology. So it's in a way an adoption at a micro level. Did they do that one course? And also at a macro level, do they believe that this works and can actually take the business and deliver results? So there's adoption at the kind of individual level and adoption at the organizational level. And we've, over the years, been successful in driving adoption. So back to 2006, with Priory Group, 2007, Superquinn in Ireland, 2009, CMG, 2011, Cambian, e-learning awards for securing widespread adoption in organizations that had no e-learning. Okay, so I'm going to share with you some of the tips that we've put together over the years. HC1 is another example of huge adoption, went from zero in e-learning to completing one e-learning course every 2 minutes, 365 days per year. And in the first year, 325,000 completions. And because they've got that alignment right, they're also getting the impact part. So it's not just about the bums on seats, but it's actually about making a difference. Okay, what are some questions to ask at the start of a project or as you're thinking about improving adoption? I like to think of it as a journey that someone has to go on to get one completion or to interact with the system at least once. So what are the steps that person needs to go through in order to complete a module? And there will be many. Maybe they have to get time away from their workstation. Maybe they have to find out about it in the first place. Maybe they need a logon and a password, and they need to know how to use the system. And all these things line up as barriers and enablers along the path to get that person from where they are to where you want them to be, okay? So think about that. What is the path that person needs to go through to get from A to B? Who are the key influencers along the way? There'll be colleagues, buddy systems, and things people can say, I'll show you how to do that. There'll be line managers who make it either a priority or not, for that person to interact with the learning technology. So different influencers along the way are going to make a difference. And what are maybe some of the barriers and enablers? These can be physical. It could be that the team is always on the road, but your e-learning is internal network only, and so it's you're fighting a losing battle right from the start. You can send out all the emails you want with links and things, but they're not in the office. They can't actually access it. So adoption is more than just sending out emails and making mouse mats and things and communicating the launch. It's thinking about all of those barriers that stop a person from getting from where they are to interacting with what you've put in and learning. So again, we're back to this. But this time, rather than thinking about our specific learning intervention, we're thinking about the structure, the management, the culture that this is going into. Is this a supportive culture? We might have HR measures in place that are either working for us or against us in getting people to interact with it and complete training. So are there incentives in place that are helping us, or are they working against us? And then physical environment, like we were talking about, people out of the office, is the IT environment accepting? Do people have tablets if they need to access the training? So those things come into place as you're thinking about adoption. Okay. There are a few reasons, in all different types of projects, not just e-learning, but a few reasons why when we put something in, it doesn't get adopted. It fails, okay? Too much complacency. We think, well, if we build it, they'll come, no problem. Weak champions, people aren't out there actually talking about it, backing us. Maybe the vision's not clear. We're going to focus on under-communication for a few minutes, because that's one that it's very easy to think we've communicated enough when really we haven't, okay? But take this example. This comes from a book on change management. Estimates that the average communication going to an employee in 3 months from its internal hierarchies and emails coming from management is about 2.3 million words or numbers. Okay, so that's kind of gives you an idea of the amount that someone's trying to process. Typical change communication, about 13,000 words. Okay, and that is a 30-minute speech, like this. Okay, trying to encourage and enthuse, a 1-hour meeting that a person sits in on the subject, 600-word memo, 2,000-word article. We would say, if we did that, I think we'd say we've done quite a lot to launch our program. But if we think about it in terms of how much market share, in terms of all the communication, all the noise that's going on in the organization, it's less than 1% of what that person's taking in. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't make a difference with those things. You definitely can. But I put this here just to remind you that what you are immersed in a project, you're living it. Every day you're thinking about it, you're having meetings about it, you're talking to suppliers. The rest of the world doesn't know anything about it. And all they know is what you've written in those memos and put into those staff meeting notes, okay? So whatever you think is enough is probably not enough, and you need to do a bit more on the communication side, okay? This is a chart that shows when we bring in some kind of change, people go through this process. The immediate is shock, then denial, then anger, then some sort of kind of reluctant acceptance. So if you're putting in e-learning for the first time, expect your managers, expect your people, expect your training team to go through this cycle. And you've got to keep communicating and helping them through the cycle. It's a long-term change program that leads to full adoption and enthusiasm at the end of it that really gets those impact results. When we put together a communication plan at the start of a project, we're thinking about those influencers, those people that are going to help our learners get from A to B. And they form our audience column. So we've got people like line managers there. We have the end user. We have the staff member. But it's surprising how little they need in terms of communication. and how important it is that you actually influence their line manager, their manager, in order to get the adoption through. Because the line manager is the secret ingredient, I would say. Focus on communicating with the line manager. Let them know. You may want them to free up the staff member to go and take part in an e-learning course, or to encourage them to get it done by the end of June, whatever it is. That might be your objective for the line manager. In order to get them to do that, you need to be thinking, what's in it for that person? What's in it for that line manager if this program works? And there you're going back to your impact and hopefully pulling some of those impact messages out and saying, if we do this, this is going to make a difference for the business in this way, or the organization is going to be different here. Some line managers will respond to compliance stats saying, has your team done it or not? And so that might be something that you need to say. You are responsible for getting your team through this. It has business benefits. And helping them through that. But communicating with line managers is very important. Be thinking about your channels. We're not inventing new channels here. You're thinking about our intranet already exists. Our employee newsletter is already there. The question I always ask is, when do the managers get together? How often? Where is it? Can we get 5 minutes on the agenda? Can you, learning and development, get 5 minutes on the agenda? That meeting is already happening. It doesn't cost you anything to get those people together. They're already together. Get your 5 minutes in there. Let them know that what's coming. Let them know their part in it. Let them know how it will benefit them and what they need to do. And get on that agenda. Use that channel. And then your deliverables will be, maybe it's a poster, maybe it's something on the internet, maybe it's a video. These will be the actual things that you're going to create to share the message with those different audiences. It's important to remember that not every message needs to be heard by every audience. So you should be talking to line managers and appealing to something with them. You might be appealing to something else with the board. You might be appealing to something else with your end user. Okay? So different messages for different audiences makes a difference. And at the end of it is a communication plan with messages aimed at those different audiences that can be used in articles, can be used in speeches by the CEO, can be used in staff meeting presentations. But you've thought it through, you know what you need people to do, and you stick to your messages, stick to the plan, and deliver. For something like HC1 and the touch rollout, this is a graphical representation of the different milestones and the different things that we were doing to communicate that. So this is to 15,000 people, almost 250 different homes across the UK. So a lot was going on. But you can see it starts back in January 2012. The launch was actually in September of 2012. So more than 6 months before, we were communicating with the organization about what was coming. And that carried on, and it still carries on now. We're reinforcing the positive messages, the things that have been accomplished by all of this work, the things that the people themselves have done and been able to accomplish, and that's reinforcing. People are enthusiastic about the program, so that when someone new joins, they happily say, come sit down, I'll show you how to use the system. It's really easy, and I'll show you how to get started. And so they've got that help at induction. Okay, one other reason why change initiatives sometimes fail is that the change is not baked in. This gets to our physical barriers. We talked about the people out on the road and can't get access to the things that are happening internally. HC1 decided they were going to do videos to train their home managers, get them to actually watch a seasoned home manager do certain key tasks. So they put those on video and put those on tablets so that people could use them as they roamed around. Daiichi Sankyo, a pharmaceutical company, people on the road, people in NHS hospitals, in waiting rooms, not sitting at a desk. So things needed to be responsive. Things needed to be mobile. We had to reduce those physical barriers in order for the adoption to happen. Yes, there was all the communication going on as well, but in this case, it was the physical barriers that needed to be overcome in order to make adoption happen. Okay, so just some examples of what is the impact, what is actually happening up in that quadrant. HC1, 10% increase in Gallup 12 measures of staff engagement. Okay? So when you get your alignment right and you get adoption right, you start to see good things happening. And one of them was people more engaged with the work they were doing. Okay? Fewer incidents, impressed inspectors, 5-star ratings. The care that they've delivered has improved. These are coming from managers. They're coming from residents. They're coming from family members saying these sorts of things. The staff feel more confident. It's reinforcing the kindness in all they do. So alignment, adoption, working together to get some of those impacts. Managers saying in very high numbers that it's made a positive operational impact on the business. We couldn't get that by just having something that was aligned and not adopted, or adopted but not really aimed at improving the business. Those two things work together to create that impact. They were reviewed by the UK government, the Cavendish Review, and pulled out as a benchmark as best practice in care training. So all of these things with aligned on kindness and getting that adoption right led to some great impact. Their own staff, when asked what's the best thing that HC1 has done for you in the last 12 months, training. Predominantly. I know I've moved quickly and I've given some tips there. Again, I'd say the article that talks about alignment and adoption is in this month's Inside Learning Technologies. We have some copies over on the Acteon stand if you'd like one. And we also have sponsored and written some parts of two towards maturity in focus reports, one on aligning learning, which was revised and republished earlier this year, and one on building engagement or adoption, which will come out in the next week or so. And both of those, the summaries are available over on the Acteon stand if you're interested. Okay? So as you go away, think about those questions that we raised. Think about aligning your training project with where the business wants to go. That's how you'll be able to demonstrate that we're actually making a difference in learning and development. That's how you'll be able to win that budget and say, actually, I can put these resources and I can influence that. We can make a difference. So think about alignment and then think about what you're doing on the adoption front and make sure those two things are working together for impact. Okay? Got time for a couple questions if you have any. Otherwise, I'll let you have your lunch. Okay, thanks very much.